As it is, I'm really nervous. Now I have this thing in front of me also, so you can hear my breathing also. Okay, so I came to talk about something that has been important to me as an artist. Like when I started being an artist, freedom was really important to me, and it still is. Because I keep going back to the question, if I'm not free as an artist to say what I want to say and put out my unique voice, then why am I not doing anything else? Why am I here making films, or why am I? So behind the scenes is what I've been asked to talk about. I think that the most important thing that people don't get to know about, that is not just behind the scenes, but also behind, inside me, which is an artist's inner journey and struggle, is the struggle to remain free. And films, as we all know, are a very expensive medium. So I'm just going to talk about what has been my journey in trying to maintain or seek freedom as a filmmaker. When I was about 20, 21 years old, I mean, we all grew up on Bollywood films, and I was no different in college. I wanted to be Raj and Rahul, and some part of me still is, I think, or tries to be in a relationship. I went and worked as an assistant director in a film for the first time, and that was when I was about 20, 21. And then I went to FTI and I did my postgrad in film screenplay writing. And when I came out, I felt the world will be waiting with open arms, because you've gone to FTI and, you know, 6,000, 5,000 people apply and you have 8 seats. Then I went through depression because I couldn't even make 5,000 rupees a month, as if I had to write something that I wanted to say. So back to freedom, like, are you saying something you really want to say? Something that you feel strongly about, not anyone else around you? If not, then why are you here? So that question kept bothering me. And for a long period of time, I left cinema because I think I was disillusioned by the fact that there wasn't enough freedom for me to say what I wanted to say. And I got into advertising, I wrote novels, I did a lot of things. And I won't talk about all that because I think it's not pertaining to what I'm trying to say. But I came back to cinema at the age of 35, by which time I felt that I have been able to find more freedom as a filmmaker. How? So when I was a novelist, we self-published our books. So my wife and I used to stand on the roads of Bombay and sell the books by hand. We sold about 1,000 copies by hand. And slowly, slowly, a national distributor came to us and said, hey, we've heard about your book, and would you like to put it on a Flipkart and then in Crossword and Landmark and all that. So I had understood that if you want to say something yourself, then put your money where your mouth is. Now, how do you do this with film? Because it's really, really expensive. So yeah, bringing it back to this whole thing. So what is freedom to me with film? Freedom with film, or any art form to me, is being able to shut out all the noise outside to give vent to the noise within me. Because there is noise within all of us, and that's the beauty, I think, of being human. There's a lot more anxiety and a lot more noise inside us than maybe in animals. Because they can't talk, so who knows. But it seems like that if you go to Africa. So I'll just talk about, so since I said block out the outside noise and give vent to the noise within, let me talk about what the outside noise is for me, for a filmmaker. One is that noise of commerce, which everyone understands. Films are a very, very expensive medium. And for someone like me and my wife, we've grown up in the middle class, done jobs all our life, to put our entire life savings in also, and to borrow, or not borrow, but get crowdfunded up to a tune of, let's say, 25 lakhs, plus our whole life savings, plus, let's say, selling a house that we had bought as an investment, a small house in Nasik, after, like, saving for very long, we still only reach a very small indie film. That's how expensive filmmaking is in general. So that commerce, basically, the minute commerce enters art or filmmaking, it starts taking away your voice, like, starts taking away your freedom, to my mind, as a filmmaker. Because then what do you start doing? You start going with an actor that is known, basically safe options. All art is about being on the front foot, pretty much like cricket. The minute you're on the back foot, I think you're worried and you're second guessing every decision of yours. So again, back to freedom. How do you keep staying free? Basically what we did is we crowdfunded the film, put in our life savings so that it's no one else's money at stake. Because the producer would have got a known star, we would have gone to a known studio, they would have tried to repeat a known story, or they would have stuck to a known genre, and we didn't want to get into all that. So that was one thing. That's one thing that I think as a filmmaker, one needs to focus on to remain free is to free yourself of commerce as much as is possible. Even though it is a very expensive medium, you can make it really controlled by making a film for as less as you can. So you get actors who are really good actors, but you don't go after stars. You produce a film yourself. You can learn everything that you need to produce a film. You don't need to go to a studio who has done 100 films. You can learn. I have done screenplay, story, screenplay, dialogues, lyrics, vocals, some part of music, and the action direction in my first film. That's about 7 credits. So just learn how to do things yourself. Everything that is put in front of us as a very big thing, hawa jo jis cheez ka banta hai, like action direction, is something that can be learned. Every small thing can be learned. And by doing that, you can stay free. You can stay free of commerce as much as is possible. Then hiring hungry people. I mean, people who are really hungry and want to get someone in life. When you hire those kind of people, instead of, if you have to get an assistant director, instead of hiring someone who has done 10 films as an assistant director, take someone who's never done it before. Or someone who's just done it once. Someone who's hungry to go ahead. That way you can stay free of commerce. Moving on, the second thing that to my mind, in my internal journey, is what I fight with to stay free as a filmmaker, is what people think of you. If you make a, let's say Rohit Shetty makes an action film, next time people expect an action film. So the people who like Rohit Shetty and the people who dislike his films all have a certain stance on his films. So that's what people think of him. When you make your next film, you start getting worried about what people think of you. So you don't go away from what you know. You don't want to upset both like boats, the people who like you and people who don't like you, because both are dangerous. And that again is your freedom goes for a toss. So if, for example, I make my first film as a feminist filmmaker, and my second film is about a man's perspective. Maybe it is about a chauvinist man's perspective and his upbringing and why he does what he does. That might put me in a lot of trouble, but I'll still make it if that's what I feel really strongly for in that year. Giving vent to the voice, the noise inside. Second point is try to stay free of what people think of you. I think that applies even in life, but even as an artist and most importantly as a filmmaker, because it's so expensive and there's so much pressure on you to do something safe time and again. Third thing that I think is important to talk about is the alliance of people in power. Now, when I was making my first film, I knew for sure that if I get, let's say, some really famous director to like my film, to come and watch it at a private screening and say, wah wah, tune kya film banai hai, then that, if that person's name comes on board, or if that person starts promoting my film, or you have XX person presents before my film, that'll get it into every festival and that'll get it everywhere. But I chose again to not get into that because the alliance of people and power in film is a big problem. The minute you try to get the alliance of people and power, you try to get a big producer, a star, a big director, someone else to start presenting your film, putting their name on your film, you start losing freedom. Because it becomes their voice. Your voice is your life's experience, your childhood, your nurturing, your nature, all those things coming out and trying to deal with society and say something. But then it becomes their voice. So there was another thing that I felt one should be conscious about. Then the pressure of having to grow and expand. So most indie filmmakers, mostly, not all of them, fortunately, will start and make a film with really honest, good actors, with an honest crew, with money from their own pocket. And then once that film has done well, they'll use that to go and work with a star. You can actually see the history of independent cinema in our country, and that happens. The next film is with Amitabh Bachchan, or next film is with Vidya Balan, next film is with, you know. We stuck to that. We are now making a fourth film in January, and we've constantly stuck to just good actors. We've constantly stuck to just casting from a bloody good audition. We've constantly stuck to people who are working because they are in love with the script and they want to tell that story with you, and they're team members for you. They're not your employees. They're not coming to work. They're not coming to a job. I think that's really, really important. And of course, why I'm saying this is because the pressure to grow and the pressure to expand is upon all of us. Every time you meet someone, so often people have told me, "Acha, aage kya kar raha hai? Badi film kab bana raha hai?" That bada bada, I think, is a big problem. Why do we need to go big? Why? You can go deep. You don't need to go big. Like a relationship, like a marriage. You can go deep. You don't need to go big all the time. You don't need to have fancy vacations. You can just have a vacation, spend time with each other. So that idea of not, like, I think whether it's milk or it's film, when you take milk and you want to give it to 50 people in a village, you can actually have a relatively happy cow, let that cow graze, like free range, you know, growing or maintaining cattle, and you can give fresh, pure milk to 50 people. The minute you want to give it to 100, 500, 5,000, preservatives, tetra packs, there's no nutrients left in that milk, there's nothing left. And I think it's the same with cinema, and it's the same with any art form. If you get tempted by numbers, if you get tempted by growth too much and you want to go big, big, big all the time, even in a company, then you become like many, let's say the most famous cell phone company in the world right now, which I think everyone would agree has changed a lot in its principles over the last 5-6 years. So yeah, I think that's what happens. Growth is actually the enemy of, I think, depth and purity. So I think all these things actually apply to everything, but I'm talking as a filmmaker. The last one that I want to talk about in terms of the outside noise, these are all things we're dealing with to push away so that we can give vent to the noise inside. The outside noise, the last thing is freedom from reactions. So what I realized as an artist when I was writing novels is that you get so affected by reactions as an artist because it almost feels like someone's talking about you, not about the work of art. It's almost like a personal comment. If someone says this is not good, or this person, sorry, could you just not talk here? Excuse me. Sorry, you'll have to just not talk here. Thanks. So if you basically let reactions get to you, they can really harm you. And I think the more dangerous ones are the good ones because you get stuck in where you are. Someone says you're such a good feminist filmmaker. That's it, stuck. Because now I think I'm a feminist filmmaker and that's it. Then freedom is gone. You aren't free anymore because you see yourself a certain way, the way people want to see you. So yeah, reaction. So what did we do? We made Tikli and Laxmi Bomb as our first film. And then our second film, Tota Pataka Item Mal, was ready and made and free from me before Tikli and Laxmi Bomb got released. So now for 4 years, we've done that practice. Every film that we make, we've already made the next one before the first one is released. So whatever reactions, if people really rip my film apart also, I can't go back on the back foot and second guess my decisions in the next film. That's something that we can all think about in our own lines of work. And I think with filmmaking, because it's really difficult, no one does it. But actually, it's just timing. The validation that you seek from your first project, wait. If you're a writer or anything, or a musician, wait for the next song to be ready. Then put out the first song, so that you're not second-guessing your decisions on your second piece of work. So that's something we'll be doing time and again. Now about the inside noise. So all this you do so that you can vent the inside noise. What is the inside noise? The inside noise is my insecurities, my fears, my sadness, my impulses, everything that is in my id, that is in my unconscious mind. My job as an artist is to vent those. And my job as an artist, as a filmmaker, is to vent those in film, in cinema, as all the greats have over time. And I think to be able to do that, you need to remain free. So that your unique voice, with your unique nurturing and nature, can go out into the world and you can grapple and deal with the issues that you feel strongly about. What is that inside noise? It is sublimation of your insecurities, your fears. What is sublimation? It's a very interesting definition from what I understand, and please correct me if I'm wrong. Sublimation is when you go from the solid state straight to the gaseous state. You miss the liquid state. How does it apply in an artist's life? My insecurities, my fears, my complexes, my impulses, my desires, if they manifest themselves directly in my life is over, my personal life, which is why most artists have very, very wayward personal lives. But the job of the artist is to sublimate that into the art. So it escapes my life, mostly, and it goes into the art. And it actually, when someone else sees that story, they're able to vicariously go through that emotion, that pain, and it somewhere releases something in them. That's why when you see a Munda Bhai at the end, something gets released. When you see Lagan at the end, when that sixer happens, something gets released. What gets released? Your sense of oppression for years, your sense of oppression even at a workplace, your sense of oppression in the house, anywhere. When that sixer happens, all of us find that release in that film. And that happens when you sublimate your own thing. And only when you keep yourself away from the outside noise and allow that inside noise to determine your every next story and your next piece of work, will this happen. If you get bogged down by what people think of you or all the other things that are listed, then you'll never be able to give vent to that unique voice that you have inside. Okay, and so once I have all this freedom and I'm starting to make my film, how do I maintain it or what do I do with that freedom? Give other people freedom. I realized long back that when I was a novelist, it should be a lot of great pride for me. As a novelist, I used to see filmmakers who had said, a film by Martin Scorsese, a film by this one, that one, and I used to see, wow, so great, I want to be that person. And when I got into film, in my first film itself, I realized that films are such a collaborative medium that I will never write. In fact, if I write a film by Aditya Kriplani someday, please mail me, message me on Facebook and say, you said this in a TED talk, why are you doing this now? Because I never want to do that. I think films are a really hugely collaborative medium, and the beauty of cinema is that it is about everyone. So when I said, what do I do with that freedom? I help other people have a voice. So in our films, at least the attempt is always that the editors, the first cut is always the editors, and we try to maintain as much of that as possible. as possible. I don't go in and say I want this shot, that shot from the start and kind of maul the editor's first cut. It's always a practice. The DOP, for example, I have a style of filmmaking wherein we move around the actors and the actors almost never look into a camera. They never stand on a mark. So it makes things much more realistic because they talk to each other and we go and shoot on real locations. For a DOP, this is very difficult because finding focus and lighting is very difficult when you can't have a mark for an actor because focus changes with every step here and there. So my camera person came and told me after two films together, she was really frustrated because she can never set up ground lights because I move around anywhere with the actors. So always lighting is on top, like right now. And I had to listen to it. And I had to think that, okay, I am here to have my voice, but her voice also needs to come in. She likes a certain design aspect to the film, and she must have a voice. So that, I think, is what you do with freedom. You give it to others, and you get more free. It's a beautiful thing about freedom. So that's one thing. So everyone in our films has their voice. My chief AD has her voice. She's here, Anuradha, today. Everyone who works on our films, we try to see to it that they have their voice in the film. So it's a collaborative effort. The final thing, what do I do with that freedom? Or how, like the most poetic thing about freedom is that I want all that freedom so that I can finally just submit to the script. This is St. Mira's College. It's a college that talks about devotion. And this is all I am. I'm a devotee to the writing. It comes in the middle of the night. The ideas or the thoughts, they come to me when I'm in the toilet. I'm sitting on a hop-on, hop-off bus in London. Some guy is talking about Trafalgar Square and I get an idea. I will stop. I'll start writing right there. I'm in a local train. There are people arguing, people standing. I don't have a place to stand. I will take out my book and write if something comes to me. So I'm 100% devoted. So the beautiful thing about freedom is that I take all that freedom and I'm just in service to something else. And that's the beautiful thing about freedom. It only multiplies when you are in service of something else, in some sense. This is basically what I wanted to talk about. How to eliminate outside noise as an artist, and mostly in my case as a filmmaker, and give vent to the noise inside, which I see as my job as a filmmaker. In terms of the halfway there thing, the beautiful thing is that with freedom, you can never have achieved it. It's like equality. I think equality exists in the process of equality and of finding equality. And I think it's the same with freedom. Freedom only exists in the process of trying to achieve it. I don't think there is any place where you are completely free, and that I think is the beautiful part of it. And so I am halfway there because there is so much to learn. Maybe tomorrow I'll learn that seeking freedom is the biggest cage. Who knows? And I'm open to that. I think that journey has to keep going on. So yeah, halfway there. Thank you.